Good evening, I'm so pleased to be here, I'm so excited. My name is Steph, and my Twitter name is @sniffles. I don't have 6,000 followers, so help me out. So, we're going to talk about studying the mundane today. It's about looking for the interesting things in the ordinary. This, when I first saw a picture of this... When I first saw a picture of this, I thought it was a real object, and I was terribly disappointed to find out it was a work of art. Now, you can apparently purchase a reproduction of this, but this is called the Coffee Pot for Masochists, and originally by a French artist, Jacques Carolman. It was part of his work, a body of work called Catalogue of Unfindable Things. Now, this is a particularly famous coffee pot for all the wrong reasons. Designers love it. It was on the cover of a book called The Design of Everyday Things. Who's heard of that? Just out of curiosity. Okay, so, well, you guys can go to sleep now. Don Norman was one of the first people to talk about use and about designing for being usable, and also, in particular, designing for pleasurable use or non-pleasurable use, just emotional reaction to things. Talking about use or studying use is really strange because it's like me trying to talk about a glass pane when you're looking through at the view. So I figured the best way I can talk about this is to talk about something that's happened recently. How many of you put your phones in your pocket? Almost everybody. Okay, so I'm not going to assume that most of you, given the amount of laughter, know about Bendgate, but just very quickly. So the iPhone 6 and the iPhone 6 Plus were released on September 19th, and just 3 days afterwards, people were complaining on social media about bent phones, and they were tweeting photos of their phones, something like this. On September 22nd, hashtag Bendgate became the trending topic on Twitter. OMG. These folks at Unbox Therapy, they decided to show a video of the presenter, Lou, bending the phone like this. That caused a lot of uproar and everything. Then, the following day, there was a conspiracy saying, oh, Matt, that video was fake. It's the internet these days. and so it went on and on and on for about 5 days straight. Including the whole thing was... including that the whole thing was overblown in the first place, so why are we talking about it? And Apple was saying, look, only 9 people formally complained. It is not a big deal. But what actually I found interesting, despite all the sort of funny headlines and things, is the kind of attitude that we typically have to the person who used something, the user, the consumer, the customer, whatever name you want to call it. I'm going to share with you some choice quotes. Bendgate is your fault, not Apple's. This is the name of the topic of the article. And the quote is, let's get one thing straight. The iPhone 6 Plus photo showing mild to severe use, bending, sorry, wasn't a result of normal everyday use. The next one came from The Guardian, which I found rather condescending. Being thin makes large phones more pocketable. I'm going, huh? And users need to think about the stress and strain in tight pockets as they sit down, regardless of whether they carry them in the back or front pockets. This is what our media writes about. It's exciting. but probably my favorite, I'm sorry, this is the Daily Mail. yes, I feel dirty too, Hannah. For example, do not have it sideways in a pocket, as your pocket will push it against your leg, possibly causing bending. Putting it in your back pocket could also have a similar effect, so storing it in a shirt pocket or bag might be a better option. And there's a whole slew of stuff around how not to bend your iPhone 6, like something like this. 6 tips to avoid iPhone 6 bending. 1, use a case. 2, avoid tight pants. Now, I think these were American, so I'm sure they meant avoid tight trousers as well. So I want to show you, so 4 days, day 4, sorry, of the whole kerfuffle, Apple felt like they had to deal with this from a publicity perspective, so they invited journalists and sort of blogger sorts to a secret testing lab, and showing that they do tests. So I'm going to show you the tiny little clip. This is cut from recode.net.
Hi.
So I don't know what you think we're thinking about. That's like, I could be the one wearing skinny jeans and sitting on phones if they wanted to pay me for it, really. But so this in particular reminded me of a very, very specific moment in the Big Bang Theory all the way back in season one. So just for your memory, for your recollection.
Okay. How about this? There's this farmer, and he has these chickens, but they won't lay any eggs. So he calls a physicist to help. The physicist then does some calculations, and he says, I have a solution, but it only works for spherical chickens in a vacuum. Right?
To think that Apple actually spent time with real human beings when they make their phones. I mean, you imagine that they would to a certain degree. But rather than just lab tests and simulate human behavior. I mean, for one thing, that they would have noticed that just about everybody puts a phone in the pocket. And it's the kind of human behavior that we've just gotten so accustomed to that it's very, very hard to change. And, well, either you're already putting phones in your pocket or you're like me, wishing that you have pockets to put your phones into. So there's a happy ending sort to this story, and it comes in the form of Ian Morris in an article from Forbes.com, and he said that people were talking about it, but actually people weren't that unhappy. So the way he found out about this was he did a Twitter sentiment analysis with the help of a company called Spreadfast, and they said, you know what, maybe the iPhone 6 is actually so good that a little bend, not a problem. But, you know, this is the sort of thing, when you're designing a product, a technology for somebody, can you predict? Can you predict whether this is going to happen or not? And one of the ways that we figure this out is that I could do things like have all of us in a room, like what we've got here now, and say, how do you use your phone? And ask you that question. But that wouldn't be very realistic because you only tell me the things that you remember and the things that you're conscious of, which is useful, but not entirely the whole story. Or I could say, let's go in the room and, well, not quite like that. And see how you use something, and see, you know, what do you do with your phone when you're not talking to somebody? Do you fiddle? Do you not? These are legitimate research methods for what I do and for what people like me do who are interested in human beings and weird things like where you put your phones. But it's not quite enough because real life is entirely messy, and it speaks loads to about how we construct our scientific experiments by listening to and watching what people do in real life. So if you have a little think about what you've done today when you got out of bed in the morning and how you got here this evening, and all the series of little things you've had to do to get here, and all the series of decisions that you have had to make to get here. A real person's day is filled with up and downs. We all know this. I'm telling you stuff you already know, see? And all the decisions, and all this affects the decisions that you make. So people like me, we hunt for evidence to predict potential scenarios before a design crime is committed. Kind of like Tom Cruise, but less sexy. This is the only diagram in the whole thing. There is actually a structure to what we do. We'll go from understanding things like, how do people live with phones? So that is a very specific question with phones. I mean, obviously, it can get a little more complex than that. And all the way down to, what do you do with your phone when you're not using it? And so there's a whole series of iterative processes that we use, and it is actually strangely scientific. We use hypothesis methods to decide what the questions are, and then find ways to validate or invalidate what we think we do in design. So I'm going to give you a little very, very basic short example that good design is hypothesis and evidence driven, and this is an unfinished story. So. This is my husband's kitchen in his office. It's very similar to many offices with dirty sinks and things in the sink. So there is a sign at the top. It says something like, please wash your dirty dishes. Do not leave them in the sink. And so what you don't know is that there's a small team of designer in that particular office. And they started doing something like this. They stuck a face up. They stuck a face up because there is a cognitive science trick that you can do. If you stick a photo, and statistically this is actually true, if you stick a photo up of someone's face looking at you, you're less likely to do wrong because you feel like morally judged. but it only worked for a week. So this one's a particular one. So there's another new sign with a dish rack saying, please fill me up, and an arrow pointing to it. But if you're careful and if you do my job, and I mean, I didn't get to go to this office because I would probably start off a whole different chain of experiments if that was the case. But if you're like me, you go, wait a second, not all the dishes are dirty, some of them are clean, do you just need a dish rack? And as it turns out, I asked that question, and really the problem they had was they couldn't know when the dishwasher was clean or dirty, or whether it's still running, because apparently there is no little light indicator. And so maybe that is actually a set of experiments to begin with to see how you can actually get people to change their behavior. So, in the wise words of someone like Jan Tschipches, who's far more famous than me and who has done more interesting things, if you want to understand people, you have to understand how people function in the wild, in the natural setting, in our natural settings, in a world of chaos and gray areas, a world of consequences, and a world that's constantly changing. Thank you very much.